appreciate everyone being here today. Since we are recording, I am really stunned to see over 2,700 people in the audience. And no laughing, stop. It'd be too loud for the recording if all of you laughed. So please, slow down. It's just awkward. But thank you very much. I'm super excited to be here. I first developed this talk, I think, in 2010, or at least it feels like 12 years ago. But we actually obviously did this for 2021, and we're very excited to be here in 2022. I'm sure all of you are. It's nice to actually be doing this in person with folks, which is probably the 30th time you've heard this if you've been at a session. So it's wonderful. Here's a lovely RSA disclaimer. Take a moment. There will be a test later. Here's my legal department's disclaimer, which basically says I'm an inveterate liar. Don't buy stock in anything I'm saying. Something along those lines. But there we go. We've done what was needed. A little bit about myself, if you don't know me. My name is Ryan Kovar. I've been at Splunk now for about 7.5, almost 8 years. My focus at Splunk has been building and creating wonderful things in the world of cybersecurity. That's what I do. Before I came to Splunk, I mostly worked in the public sector, split between the United Kingdom and the US, mostly in a role of doing nation state hunting. But I've been everything from pulling Cat 5 cable on an aircraft carrier, to doing SQL database work, to being an engineer, to being threat intel. I've pretty much, there's something in cybersecurity, I've probably touched it, which has been a fascinating part of my life, and it's kept me very not bored. For those of you who've worked with Splunk or have heard of it, Boss of the SOC is probably one of the biggest things I'm known for, which is a huge CTF. I think we've had about 50,000 people through it so far, which has been great. But most recently, I've created and started something called Surge, and I had a lot of lessons learned. So looking through this audience, I think most of the folks here are probably not early career, which is perfect, because this talk is really geared towards people who want to hire in a more interesting way. So, everything I ever needed to learn in life, I pretty much stopped school, I think, in fifth grade, or at least that's when I stopped paying attention. And I think the who, what, where, when, how, why is always how I try to organize talks. So today we're going to talk about what we're talking about, what's the crux of this discussion. I'm going to talk about who these people are that I'm actually trying to recruit, who are different than maybe we usually pull from. And by different, I mean they're not a middle-aged white man with a beard and a pot belly and glasses who work in the United States Department of Defense for 20 years. Which is a large segment of the US cyber force. Then I'm going to talk about where you can find these folks who aren't the normal people that a lot of people look at for hiring. And then I'll conclude, because otherwise I would talk for about an hour. Also, when I first envisioned this talk, I was doing a lot of work with Colonial Pipeline, so I said, heck, I like pipelines. We're talking about pipelines. Let's have a theme. So you'll see a lot of pipes. So Surge, that's the team that I started last year. We actually started it in response to SolarWinds. It was something where we saw a need at Splunk to create what I affectionately call yet another security vendor research team. That's what the world needed. But our team is, I believe, a little bit different. Our tagline is blue collar for the blue team. And what we really work on is focusing on taking extremely difficult concepts that exist in the world and trying to get them down to everyone else. I have a really long theme that I like to talk about of wizards and muggles. And the wizards are at this conference. They are at the super secret squirrel invite-only colloquiums. They are doing these incredibly interesting things, where they are talking about the Palestinian Liberation Front targeting the Liberation Front of Palestine using custom malware with a mutex that affects 13 people globally, and let's have a brand new incredible talk on it. I love that. That is what I really get into in cyber, but that probably doesn't really help you with your Patch Tuesdays and SOX compliance. And that's where I think there's a bit of a disconnect. And so what my team is, someone once affectionately said, oh, you're trying to be cyber Prometheus, bringing fire to the people from the gods. And I said, that's a little grandiose. I don't quite have the body of a Greek god. I'm a little bit more of a hedonistic Roman god with wine, but we'll kind of go from there. So that's where we started the team. And to do that mission, I need to think a little bit about who we hire. So here's a couple of the folks on the team. We have everyone from a former sales engineer, a research and development engineer from DARPA, a former journalist, a competitive Xbox gamer. We just have a lot of different folks from all over the world who've joined the team. And I want to spill the beans a little bit on how we got there, what I looked for when I was hiring, and kind of where I went through when I looked at bringing in some new folks and more junior roles or more entry level, which is actually a bias I'll talk about when I use the word junior interchangeably, which isn't true, but I still fall into that trap myself. So, how many people have seen something along these lines? right? My favorite, very recently, I didn't have time to edit the slides because RSA would have personally executed me on the floor, but somebody did post yet another 15 years of Kubernetes experience required, which is fun because the corollary is you also had to have invented time travel. So I'm not actually sure what is harder, securing Kubernetes or inventing time travel. Neither has been solved, but we're working for it. So entry-level job opening, this is very typical, and I'm going to talk about some of the words you see here. 3 years of experience, reference letter from Barack Obama. Amusingly, this gentleman in the middle, Mick Baccio, actually was the head of threat intelligence at the White House, so he could have actually had a reference letter from Barack Obama. So that part, at least, is not outside the realm of possibilities. I'm going to keep pressing buttons until something works. There we go. Thank you, sir. Everyone applaud Jim. None of this works without the wonderful AV folks in the room. So thank you. So we've talked about it here. Notice there is nothing here about a requirement of understanding how to use a slide clicker and Microsoft Office. So thank God I get to keep my job. So yeah, I had about three positions opening up on the team. And I had a lot of senior folks who looked and sounded just like me. And the thing is, I have a personal belief you don't actually need that many really smart people who could develop innovative things. You need a team to support a couple of those people. And so I wanted to create an idea where we could actually have folks who are working to support them. So I'd like to do bottom line up front. To give you an idea, for those of you who have recruited, this was the results I had. The method I went through that I'm about to describe today, I had 390 applicants in 30 hours. I was able to down select that to 20. I talked to 20 people on the phone. I had 10 candidates I moved forward with, and I ended up with four perfect people to hire. I picked two. I could have picked any of the four, and I'm very proud of that. And that's why I wanted to share this kind of journey that I went through for folks. If you are early career or second career or you're changing, hopefully you'll be inspired what I'm talking about to hear to look for roles that are more suitable for what you bring to the table, because that's a big theme that I'm going to discuss. So who was I trying to recruit? Notice the pipes once again. Early career. So once again, I say the word entry level, I say the word early career. I don't like using the word junior, although I do continue to accidentally trip up and say that. And the reason I don't like to say that is because I think you can bring people in who have had a different life experience, and that's not junior, they're just early in the career that you're in. And there's a lot of value that I'm going to talk about that here shortly. But the big thing that I really did find was my bare minimum was you had to be smarter than a US senator. Okay? And by that I mean you needed to understand how TCP/IP worked. I needed at least, I couldn't have the time to explain just the basics of the internet. So those were one of the areas that I was looking for. You know, hey, bare minimum, no US senators can apply. So there we go. And at Splunk, we have a concept that I'm really proud of. We call it the million data points, which is partly that every person is more than just the sum of their job. And you're bringing a lot of new things in. And I think for folks who work in cybersecurity, any of you have been threat intelligence, you know the value of having a diverse team. It's not just something that HR is happy about. It actually can change the output and the product of what you create. And that is something that actually results in impact, not just something that looks good on a PowerPoint about how diverse your company is and the United Benetton of colors for a marketing team. It actually makes an impact on your analytical capabilities. So when I looked at this, one of the things I really wanted to talk about was, I don't care if you just graduated with a computer science degree. I have to train you anyway. I don't care if you have a discrete math degree. I have to train you anyway. I don't care if you just graduated from a boot camp. I have to train you anyway. So suddenly, what am I always saying? I have to train you anyway. Great. So if you can speak the lingua franca, if you have the taxonomy, it doesn't matter what you've done, I'm going to have to train you. So then you start opening up your aperture on what's available. So how did I get these folks? How did I get those two perfect hires that I'm so happy with? A very, very patient recruiter. And I say this because I like a lot of people actually fight against their human resources and their recruiter. This is actually mine, Heidi Smith. I don't know if she's in the room today with all 1,300. I can't see the back, guys, for those on the recording. It is so far, it's actually foggy. But she was wonderful. She really took a chance on this when I said, hey, I kind of get weird on my recruiting strategy. And she kind of stopped and said, I am in HR in some way. What do you mean weird? And I just more said, like, I want to write my own job description. I don't want to copy the boilerplate. I want to do something myself. And she said, okay, let's try it out. And a couple years ago, I spoke at a SANS new to cyber talk, and I have a concept that I believe in, and I'm going to pick on Kubernetes again. You are 2 years away from being a world expert in something. right? There's that 10,000 hour methodology. I think it's even less in cyber. And I say this because I've been doing cyber for about 25 years in one way or another. The first 5 years of my career, I really learned the hell out of BNC connectors, AppleTalk, Windows NT 4.0, Exchange 5.5. None of that matters. I have 20 years of knowledge that don't matter anymore. The last 5 years of actual security knowledge is important. 20 years of experience, that does help. That means I have more wisdom. But actual knowledge, it's only about 5 years of things that I actually care about. And so when you start thinking about that, if you are new to cyber, or you're looking at hiring someone in new to cyber, realize they could be speaking at RSA 2024 about the technology that was released today as the global expert, and they could have only been in this industry for 3 years. And once again, that's phenomenal. It's exhausting for me because it means I have to read a lot more every day. But that does change, once again, how you're thinking about who you hire. And I want to make another clarity, in my opinion. Experience does not equal knowledge. This is something that we do because we're all lazy. I still do it as well. I've used the word experience today, haven't I? But what I mean by this is, I know people who've been a Unix admin for 20 years. I know a college graduate who flunked out of his CS program, who spent the entire summer reverse engineering the Linux kernel, and now is an active contributor to that project. Who do you think knows more about Unix? The graybeard who knows how to do a tarball every day for his job, or the guy who's actually submitting pulls and PRs into the kernel project? Experience does not necessarily mean knowledge. Experience is usually a buzzword or a byword for wisdom. And there's value there. I'm just not going to talk about it today because I have none of it to share. But I do have this little slide, which I think is appropriate. So I'm a big fan of cognitive thought models, which is a fancy way of thinking, of saying that I just like to write things down and pretend it looks fancy and put them in pyramids. So when I first started this job, I really wanted to delineate between what was a need and what was a want. And as always, if you're familiar with the hierarchy of needs for a human, there's actually very few, right? Food, water, and shelter. And I think one of the problems I see in a lot of job requirements, my hierarchy needs right now is coffee, is that people put a lot of wants in a role. I want this and I want that. What you really need is someone who gets in front of a keyboard and can type. What you want is someone who can do everything. They can program, they can do, you know, Python, they can speak publicly, they can do data science, they can also do your backups, and maybe if they're in an entry-level role, they're okay picking up Krispy Kremes on Friday. Those are all wants, not needs. So we actually sat down and really broke down what our needs were. And for us, the very first one was, as I said, at least higher than a US senator for IT knowledge. And by that I mean, I'm not gonna have time to teach you what an IP address is. I don't have time to teach you what DNS is. I don't have time to teach you the word event log. You need to come to me with that taxonomical knowledge. I'm not saying you have to be an expert in it, but if I say like, hey, I want you to go research passive DNS, I can't have you saying like, great, first off, what's passive in terms of DNS? Second, what is DNS? Right, so that was my bare minimum. That's the platform that we went into. The second was, my team is externally focusing. We are a research team. We have a lovely mantra that comes from the academic world, publish or perish. If my team isn't publishing, we don't deserve to exist. We are not an ivory tower. We are, as someone said, the cyber Prometheus, just a little bit more portly than a Greek god. So I needed to have people who are comfortable communicating orally or written. And I was fine with either. We have places for both. But if you're like, God, I hate writing, I hate speaking in public, there's probably a different role for you that's not on my team. The third was a passion for cybersecurity, which I know is a little bit controversial on the Twitters. But for me, it is something. I love what I do. I love what we work on. And I find it's very difficult for people to do research if they're not passionate about the subjects that they're looking at. That does not mean I'm expecting that people work 80-hour weeks. What I am expecting is for natural curiosity and inclination to keep digging, which I don't find with passion, or if you don't have passion in that subject. Notice we're getting smaller and smaller in my needs here, right? These are approaching wants, but there's still things I need. So technical knowledge. I have a lot of technically proficient people that I work with already. So it'd be really nice to have, right? It'd be nice to have as a need a technical knowledge. That's less important than the bottom three, but man, it starts making a difference when I start looking at the candidates. And the final was independent. We started off in this, you know, COVID world. As I said, I was looking for entry-level people. And I don't know how many folks here started their careers in pre-COVID. I'm gonna guess most of you. And for many people, myself included, when you start in this industry, you're pretty much paired up with a senior curmudgeonly person who probably looked just like me, a little bit older and 30 years ago. And the way that worked is they were just kind of your mentor. They were your apprentice. There's a wonderful white paper that was actually written by an anthropologist who actually went in and embedded themselves in a sock for 3 years and tried to figure out the tribe of the sock. And one of the big things they talked about is tribal knowledge and how a lot of times you're not promoted until they feel like you've earned it, like you haven't suffered enough. I'm not going to teach you. You figure that out yourself. And when you've proven it, I will unlock the next level of knowledge for you. How the hell does that work in COVID, right? 100,000 Zooms. So it's still possible. I was very willing to consider someone who is entry level, early career, that did need to have an hour of Zooms a day. But as we show in my little pyramid, that was probably the least of my needs. But it wasn't a want. I didn't need someone who could be independent because I didn't have time to sit for 6 hours a day in a Zoom and walk through every part. So how do I find this sort of person? I wanted to write a job description that was more inclusive. I find that most job descriptions are intended to weed out before you apply. I instead wanted to flip that and let me do the weeding before I actually talk to the person. So some things I really worked hard around was exclusionary terms around gender and years of experience. I think years of experience is bullshit. I've said why. I stand by that pretty thoroughly. Gender, that's something I do by default. It's something I work very hard to figure out how not to. I think most of us were taught in one way or another to use gender in language when we write. But for job descriptions, I don't think it has a great place and should be stricken. And there's tools that I'll talk about to get rid of that. I am really cool with second career folks applying. In fact, I will say I have a bias towards it, which I'm okay with. Why? Because of that top need. I always say it's nice to hire someone where you don't have to explain where the toilet is. And what I mean by that is if you hire someone who's second career, they've already worked in the professional workforce. They understand the concept of expense reports. They understand the concept of going off for a doctor's appointment and coming back. And there's nothing wrong with your first job. I have no issues with that. But I'm also really okay with second careers. And my other thing that I love about people with second careers, I'll talk about this in a bit, is they often come with a superpower. Right? They're coming in with a second job, a whole world of experience that you can leverage that has nothing to do with the job that they have. I'll talk about it in a minute. Once again, I wanted to tell them what the needs are, not the wants that I had. And I think I've explained why that's a little bit different. And the final part is, and hopefully you're getting this in a talk at 8:30 on the third day of RSA, we have a really fun team, at least I think we do. Splunk's a great company to work at. My team is explicitly pretty fun and engaging. So I wanted to write a job description that kind of embraced that, right? They thought, oh, this is a fun place to work. This is even a fun job description. If it's a fun job description, the job's probably going to be fun. My team might disagree after this year worth of incidents, but that was the goal. So I wrote a job description. We're going to do an Amazon six-pager. Everyone read this for 20 minutes, and that's the end of the talk. Thanks. Obviously not. Too small. But I will give a link to that later on. Here's some example vignettes. My team does a lot of LinkedIn Live panels. It's a great platform to get out there. We do one every Tuesday, or actually I'm doing one later today because it's one day at RSA. We do YouTube Lives, we do Twitter Spaces, we do things like that. Once again, I'm giving a flavor of what our team does. If that's not something you're interested in, maybe not the right job for you. We do CFPs, publish or perish. I actually have MBO for CFP submissions, so I actually judge the team on how many CFPs they put in every quarter. Notice I did not say accepted CFPs, but I do believe by writing and practicing and submitting, you get a lot of experience that's very useful for you. And the more you send out there into the void, the more tears you shed on the altar of the RSA stage, the more likely you are to be accepted. And that is one of the things we're working on. I really wanted someone who could help us copy edit. I'm not great at the written language, and we do a lot of blogs. So once again, it was going to be great if we could hire someone who had that experience. And I work in a sales company. We sell software. My team is about as far away from that specifically to still be in the sales org, but at the end of the day, Splunk sells software. And if that's not something you're comfortable with, probably not the company to come to. Qualifications. Talked about a bit this, you know, I keep hammering on this experience thing, right? It's probably the most controversial. I needed someone who did things. I didn't really care what they did. I had a whole menu of things. Maybe you're awesome at Python. Maybe you know Python. Maybe you're a copy editor. Maybe you work in social media and you're awesome at TikTok videos. Maybe you're just a phenomenal speaker. Maybe you're coming out of academia and you know how the hell to write an academic cited paper, which if you've never been through a graduate program, that's a thing. That's a difficult thing to explain to someone why it matters how you do citations or what a literature review is. That's something I use a word of quite a bit, literature review, and if you haven't been in academia, that might be a little bit of a confusing statement. I find a lot of value if someone has been. I'm not looking for one person to have all those things, and this kind of goes back to that concept of a superpower. If you have a second career, maybe you were a journalist. I'd love to hire a journalist. I did hire a journalist. And she came in with like the ability to write and communicate, and she knew enough about cyber for me to go, hey, your superpower brings everything else up. That's awesome. As I said, in the qualifications, communication was non-negotiable. That was about the only thing. If you were a wallflower, there are a lot of great jobs in cybersecurity for you to be a mushroom in a closet and never see or talk to anyone. This is just not that job. And I wanted to make that clear right off the bat. I didn't want anyone confused about that. And then finally, I really worked hard to get people to not self-select out. I see that I do a lot of mentoring with women in technology and minorities in technology. And one of the biggest things, oh, there's 13 things on that job ad, and I only have 12 of them. I'm like, I'm a middle-aged white male. Like, oh, there's one thing, I know that word, hell, I'll apply, right? How do I make a job advert that kind of lets people embrace that and not self-select out by giving them enough areas of what I need that they feel like they have the opportunity to apply and be worthy? So we put in very explicitly, I don't care if you're coming back, when I wrote this job description, we were pulling out of Afghanistan. I don't care if you're a squatty coming back from Afghanistan. I don't care if you're a mom who's just coming back after 10 years out of the workforce, but man, you've got some skills. Maybe you're a librarian. Maybe you're a data scientist. Maybe you're a sysadmin. Maybe you're a journalist. These are all areas. Apply. You have relevant world experience that I can work with. Because at the end of the day, I have to train you anyway. Doesn't matter if you just went to Stanford computer science program. Phenomenal program. How's that help you do Splunk and write a blog? I don't think that's like a CS 303 course, right? I have to train you anyway. I can train anyone. This is where the job description is. It's on Google Docs if you want it, bit.ly.humanpipeline. That's where that job description is. Or I actually do have an open role right now for a senior person. So, you know, on JobVite, look for security strategist. There you go. Unconscious bias. So as I wrote this, I'm very, very comfortable with the fact I have biases and I need to break them. I need to be more inclusive of various areas. These cognitive thought models I have are ways for me to document that and review it in a way rather than just prose that I'm comfortable with. So biases I have. I have a wonderful network of people from the last 20 years of my career, from the US military, from the US defense community, from the UK intelligence community, from the cyber community, and a lot of the folks in this room and a lot of the people I'm friends with look just like me, have the same background. I will write a job description that makes sense to me because that's what worked for me and my friends to get hired. I recognize that. So I tried to write something that was more inclusive of that, recognizing the biases I had for affinity and a whole bunch of other areas. So if you've never looked into unconscious bias, I really recommend you take some time and do some research for yourself so you recognize that. You're not going to break it. That's the point of unconscious. But you can write it down to the point where you start recognizing the fallacies in your own thoughts. So I turned to technology. Why? Because I'm a nerd. Grammarly, great tool. I love Grammarly. I think it's a way that's really helped me overcome some of my writing deficiencies. And then there's an HR tool called Textio. Many companies use this, but it actually goes through and will use some sort of AI, ML sort of thingy, NLP, and actually find exclusionary language inside of your job descriptions. Use this if you have access. Your HR department probably has. I was actually really proud. It gives you a score at the end. I did so much work ahead of time. By the time I submitted it to the HR department, it actually came out on the other side. They're like, oh, you've got a 98.7 point, you know, this is great. You don't have to do anything. So I probably did that wrong. I should have ran it through Textio first and then thought about it, but that's a good tool. I'm not paid by them or anything. I just like it. And then I got a mentor. I got a friend, Lillian Tang. She now works at Capital One. She is a woman of color. She's a primary caregiver. She's worked in NCIS. She's a badass, absolute badass. Wonderful feminist, very good friend of mine. And when I said, I went to Lillian, I'm like, hey, I wrote this job description. I want you to do a peer review. Look at this critically. Tell me where I screwed up. And she went through and she redlined a hell of it, hell of a lot of it. And we went back and forth. And there's some things I ended up keeping because it was appropriate for the role that I had. But working with Lillian as a disinterested second party who's coming in cold really helped me discover more of those biases or exclusionary language that I was using, which at that point was pretty low. But having a second party, a peer review for this, and if this sounds like a lot of work, it was, but I really experienced a lot of value for it. And then you gotta ship it, but where do you ship it? So where do we actually start looking for these wonderful humans, these wonderful candidates? First off, I actually looked. How many times have you seen people just said, I've sent it to HR, and I'll wait for the applicants to come to me, right? It's very easy to do. That's the whole point of the recruiters. However, if you're trying to be different, if you're trying to be weird, if you're trying not to just have the same people apply for the job as you always get, they have their own biases as well. They're going to keep applying to the same place. I work in a tech company. Our primary pipeline for a lot of technology are technical universities or organizations that are Ivy League. And we do a lot of recruiting, and there's nothing wrong with that. That's absolutely wonderful. But I wanted to be more embracive of folks who weren't coming from that pipeline. So I had to think a little bit outside the box. And once again, Heidi was super supportive of me doing this, but that doesn't necessarily mean she was going to do it. So the first thing, I use LinkedIn pretty heavily. It's really used for basically promoting all of my wonderful bullshit to the world. But it is a great tool for getting out there. And I have a fairly large, not stunning following, but I have probably 5,000 or 6,000 people follow me on LinkedIn. And I was able to promote there and then amplify that through friends. So very quickly, within about 20 hours, I had 20,000 views of the post. Then I also posted this on Twitter. Kyle, who's now become an internet bestie, he actually spoke this weekend at B-Sides SF about the power of social media in cybersecurity. He actually picked it up. I've never met him before. He had just read the job advert. He's like, oh, this is great. This is actually inclusive. And he did a TikTok on it. Within like 10 hours, he had 75,000 views of the TikTok. My own tweet that I pushed out, 170,000 views in about 16 hours. Right, so 160 or 170,000 people saw that tweet because of the amplification. Now, once again, I don't have a huge social media following. I have about 6,000 or 7,000 people, which is not gigantic by any means. But what I did do was be proactive. So I'd done a whole bunch of research before and found organizations on Twitter and other places that amplify messages or focus on underrepresented groups in cybersecurity. So in here, you'll see things like Black Girls Who Code, diversity, tech, women impact, WESIS, a whole bunch of organizations like that. I had my primary tweet, and then I subtweeted and say, hey, early career role, please check it out, amplify if you can. And they did, and that's why I had such a big return on investment. This is a lot of work, folks. 10 minutes of Googling really pushed my day, delayed my coffee, right? But my point here, I was proactive. I didn't just put something on our JobVite site and hope that the people who continue F5 that applied. I reached out, I tried to find folks who were underrepresented in an organization and organizations that supported them to do that. So I'm also a big believer in that no one actually ever wants to hear someone talk for an hour straight. So I'm actually gonna probably roll up here in the next 5 or 10 minutes and then happy to talk more about my adventure. So conclusions. I was able to hire a wonderful, diverse team. Our team is currently about 50% women globally. We have two folks in Australia, one person in Sweden, 5 or 6 in America. We have an open headcount right now that we're hiring as well. And I'm really proud of the effort that we did to hire the more entry-level roles. We ended up hiring an internal data scientist who applied, and then we also ended up hiring a journalist who was doing a second career. Some of the top tier people who applied, we had everything from a poli-sci graduate who had taken a break for a couple years to a person who had been in a rock band and had gone through some boot camps, and man, their passion was through the roof and their creativity was incredible. Like I said, I had 4 great candidates. I chose the 2 that seemed to work best for us, but I could have hired any of the 4. I could have honestly hired any of the top 10 and I would have been super happy. Here is my belief. We have a shirt at Splunk that says it's not a pipeline problem. I actually don't believe in that. I believe there is a pipeline problem for senior candidates. When I really tried to find folks who don't look like me, who are more experienced, see, now I'm using my own words that I said I shouldn't use. When I'm talking about people who've been in tech for a while, who have a lot of wisdom, who have been doing this for a really long time, who are more in tech lead roles, that pool gets a lot smaller when I get up to the, have you been doing this for a long time? However, there is a giant aquifer of untapped talent that we as an industry have turned a valve to close. We've made it too hard for them to get in that pipeline so that you can reap those benefits in 10 to 15 years. One of the things I would love to stress, if you're only thinking you have to have a computer science degree, you have to have a math degree, I don't believe in that. I think today's tooling and technology allows for a wonderful group of people from humanities to actually be a part of cybersecurity. I challenge anyone here to say the best threat intel analysts in the world are not humanities. I know people who are poetry majors, poet graduates, like graduate level poetry folks who have converted into cyber. My wife has a PhD in art history. Her job is to read, research, synthesize, and think. How different is that than my job? I use the word TCP/IP. She uses the words, you know, I can't even think of the words. They're too complicated for me. I'm a simple man. But, you know, she's looking at the ingredients in the paint and the brush strokes when they use x-rays to determine what the pre-drawing was, right? Once again, I say, if you just move 20 degrees to the right, it's the same thing. These are smart humans. They don't have the taxonomy knowledge, but they can learn that very quickly. I would just say, think of this as open your valve, and you're going to get a lot more people in the pipeline, which means in 10 years, I'll have a lot more easy time having those senior technical folks on my team look not just like me. So they have this great concept here at RSA, which is around the idea of, like, basically, what are you going to do tomorrow? What are you going to do soon? What are you going to do later? So here's my ideas. If you found this talk interesting, if you found my journey interesting through hiring uniquely, really spend time thinking about what you need versus what you want. My guess is your wants are much greater than your needs. Just get rid of your wants. You can use that if you're down to four candidates, like I was. Then I started rolling in my wants. But I got through 390 to four by just saying the needs. That was pretty wonderful. In 3 months, be intentional. That's one of the big lessons that I learned here. Folks are not intentional about reaching out to underrepresented communities, and you have to be, because those groups have often felt excluded. And of course, I'm saying this as a middle-aged white male with a DoD background, so what the hell do I know about this? Make your own opinions. But for me, I found be actively reaching out, it really changed the paradigm of folks feeling comfortable to apply. I did a lot of answering just questions. Like, I don't think I'll be a great fit. Well, why? Well, I don't know how to rip apart a PCAP and do a hex dump. Cool. I don't remember how to do that either. I have to Google, right? Like, that is most of my job, frankly, is Googling. Not Bing, but Googling. Open the aperture, I talked about this, right? That pipeline, it's not a pipeline, it's a valve. We've closed the valve or we've made it too small of a valve. So if you start thinking outside the parameters of what you're used to hiring, that can be a real game changer. And that's gonna give you a lot more interesting talent to talk to. And one of the wonderful things about COVID, if there's anything that came out of it that's good, for the most part, recent news from certain people notwithstanding, I think the world's gotten much more comfortable with remote work, which means you don't have to hire only from San Francisco or Washington, D.C. or Austin. You have huge communities of folks. And from a hiring manager point of view, guess what? They tend to be cheaper, right? Because they're living in lower cost areas. So there's advantages on both sides. I'm not saying, by the way, underpay your people. What I am saying is there's a lot more talent all over the place who don't have to worry about making rent on a 300 square foot apartment in Brooklyn. Break your biases. We all do a lot of HR training, I think. One of the few that we did at Splunk that I really walked away with that I've obviously taken to heart was we did a HR training called Breaking Biases. That's where I learned a lot of this. So you can go online and find interesting things here. But it doesn't matter if you look like me or if you look completely different, you have inherent biases in your thoughts. And I recommend really identifying those as much as you can, breaking the ones that you don't even realize you have. And kind of going through there and being methodical about it. That's where I find those cognitive thought models. That's why I created my hierarchy of needs. Like, when you write it down, it suddenly becomes evident that you actually have a bias that you were unaware of. So it's something that I found a lot of value in. In 6 months, if you're successful or you've gone through this, you have to have, it's a lot of work to start. But now that I did all this, it's very easy for me. I don't have to do all this work anymore. I have a good, you know, unique boilerplate idea of what a job description works through. My HR department is comfortable with me reaching outside of the normal avenues. I have now people within Splunk and other companies who are reaching out to me for advice of how to write more inclusive job descriptions, how to get that level of return. For those of you who have never hired before, the reason I had to say 390 applicants and we ended in 30 hours is because we were overwhelming the HR system. Most places do not get 390 applicants for a research team. That was wonderful, but it did mean that I was able to show the value of what we did here. So as you start going through this, start pairing up with organizations that will amplify your message, who will collaborate with you, find your Lillian, find someone who's willing to call bullshit when you write things that you don't intend to. That made a big difference for me. And I apologize for any swearing I've gone through. I'm still a sailor at the heart, so I get passionate about things and I get in my soapbox. So really, that's all I have today. Like I said, I don't think anyone needs to talk for an hour, so I will cut a little early. My name is Ryan Kovar. You can find me on Twitter on MeanSec, obviously on LinkedIn. And now that we're back to the real world, I'll probably be at Black Hat, DEF CON, and a conference near you someday, somewhere. As we said, publish or perish. So thank you for letting me share my journey. Hopefully that was useful for folks. Happy to take any questions or meet outside for a glass of coffee or anything like that. Thank you.
Two questions for you. One, what did you use, or was there a tool that you used, like an ATS, in order to filter through all of those, or did you write a script maybe that filtered through all of the resumes that you found? That's the first
one.
That
one's very easy.
Okay, go for it.
Bourbon and Star Trek.
Right on.
I actually read every single resume. I went through very easily.
Okay.
I found it very, because I had so clearly identified my needs, it allowed me to go through. One thing that I know is controversial, again, on the Twitters and LinkedIns, is I actually really like I really like cover letters. I know some people don't, they think it's a waste. I read every single one. It was actually one of the ways I prioritized because one of my needs was passion. And I find that people who write cover letters often have passion and they've thought through. And if you've taken the time to do that, I was going to take the time to read it personally. So that's how I kind of went through the 390 to 20. I actually got it done in the evening.
So statistically, had you kept it open, the potential for more perfect candidates
Correct.
Would have been there.
Yep.
Excellent. Second question is, given that you had your list of needs, it sounds like you had a list of competencies that you were looking for as well. Did you receive any new forms of demonstrating those competencies from candidates, or was it all resume?
That's a really wonderful point. There were some folks who did have new competencies I hadn't considered. But because I had clearly identified the needs, what I found was sometimes like I was like, oh, that was really interesting, but that didn't fit in my needs. So it didn't quite work. What I did have were some people from unusual backgrounds where their resume did not actually make them qualified for the role, but their cover letter, they pointed out what they had been doing, which didn't really fit in their resume. I also find that myself included, I don't really know how to write a resume very well, mm-hmm. But I know how to write prose a lot better. So they were able to, I think this kind of fits in your idea a little bit, but they were able to demonstrate to me via their cover letter why they were a good fit, rather than had I just looked at what was in their resume, which should not actually align.
Got it. So what I'm hearing is that the conventional methods of cover letter and resume were mostly what provided to you from candidates, but that you didn't have candidates providing unconventional things, like even though social media is still questionable usage in HR
yeah.
processes. There can still be quite a bit of information in order to demonstrate the unconventional ways of showcasing those competencies.
Actually, I have a perfect example for you.
Okay.
One of the folks, in the job description, I said, hey, you have to be comfortable communicating verbally or written, but absolutely not dancing. Right, a little bit of a joke there. And the woman wrote back and she said, oh, well, what about me in a music video? Right, and she'd actually have the career as a rock star. And I was like, oh, this shows you know how to communicate, shows you're comfortable on stage, and it shows you have a sense of humor. So that was actually one aspect that kind of worked towards that.
Are there any other methods that a candidate could use to give you information about themselves that would make them outstanding?
I did have candidates reach out directly to me, mm-hmm. Which I was fine with. I don't know if that's scalable, to your point earlier. The easiest way that I still think most of us get jobs is via third parties. So folks that had a personal recommendation, I did look at more seriously because if I had a trust of someone else, this, however, did run into my biases issue because the friends I have often look and sound like me. And so that was a very comfortable way for me to have a little bit of a filter because I'm like, man, if Dave knows this person really well and he's vetted them, then I'm more comfortable because Dave is great. But I do have some moral quandaries on that because of the biases inherent of just relying on my friends giving over. So I don't know where I've sat on that, but that was one area that I did take more attention for better or worse, if I'm honest.
Thank you. More than two questions. Sorry.
That's wonderful. Thank you. I'm glad it was helpful.
Hi, Ryan. Chris Fennell, Walmart Global Tech. Really enjoyed this. I think this was fantastic, so I'm glad I came. One of the things I was thinking about is it sounds like you've sort of enabled a pedagogical or like a developmental process in the hiring, and so it feels like it's more like I usually tell candidates to not look for a job, but look for a mentor. Mm-hmm. And it sounds like you have sort of a mentor model kind of perspective in this. Like, I'm going to put time into developing you. My question then comes, how is it with retention? Because one of the challenges of giving people great skills is that they become really popular.
100%. You know?
So what's the retention like? And I mean, of course, I want to develop people to go out, but also I need great people too. So like,
sure.
That's
no, I totally get that. Yeah. So we actually do have a very heavy focus on mentoring.
Okay.
The way I've broken up the job for some of these more early career folks is into quarters. Okay. One of which is like, hey, listen, there's a lot of gopher work, to be frank, on the team, and that's your job. So that's 25% of your time are things that, for better or worse, I can't think of a great word for it, but it's doing the gopher work. Like, hey, I need you to arrange this. I need you to do this. I need you to copy edit this. 25% of it is I'm asking them to come up with a project long term. Hello?
It's a new
year. 25% longer term project.
Okay.
25% is they're actually kind of seconded to another team member who has a different skill. And so they are dedicated to a more one of the leads researchers on the team, if they're working on, so for example, we just had a ransomware research project that came out, and I had a dedicated, more early career person working with the senior person, the lead, and their job was basically to be taught and learn that aspect. Mm-hmm. The final 25% is personal development, where I actively encourage them, like we have a syllabus for them every quarter. They are financially rewarded for getting a security plus, for getting a network plus, for getting whatever it is they need that's relevant. You know, for example, one of the people on my team, she has a master's, you know, she has a master's in data science. Like, I'm not gonna ask her to learn basic things, but she may not have experience in other areas. Mm. And so her syllabus is around that. I also only ask people to work for me for 2 years.
Oh, interesting.
I'm not saying like you have to quit after 2 years, but if I've done my job right, you're probably looking for a new role within 2 years, and I'm okay with that. I wanna build that pipeline. I want to keep these people happy and so that I can keep them for the rest of my career, because if you treat them right today, the people that treated me right in 1999, I've worked for 3 times. And now he actually works for me. So my belief is, you know, if you love them, let them free. And if they love you, they'll come back.
Yeah. Thank you. That was great.
Thanks.
So great presentation. One of the things that my company does is we take a lot of neurodivergent individuals and put them into IT and cyber jobs. Whether they've been sacking groceries and underemployed. I'm just kind of curious, has Splunk considered taking on something to get the folks who are on the autism spectrum or neurodivergent individuals into jobs?
We do have a neurodivergent ERG. We have several folks on our team who, not my direct team, but a larger group who identify as neurodivergent. I think that's a fantastic question. Where Splunk has focused a lot of work on is more in underrepresented groups. We're a big participant in something called Europe, which is a program to help disadvantaged youth kind of get into cyber. They work at Splunk for several months, and then they either retain at Splunk or we really work hard to get them other places. We also use a lot of veteran assistance programs like SkillBridge, but I don't know for sure if we have anything specifically oriented toward neurodivergence.
Thank you.
Of course. Well, wonderful. I'll just sit here and stare till the end of the presentation. But no, thank you very much for coming. I'm around all week. If you see me, like I said, hit me up on Twitter, LinkedIn, whatever you can. Hopefully this is helpful. And thank you. I really appreciate everyone making it. It's early. I barely made my own session, so the fact you're here is great. Thank you.